Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Regarding Islamic customs and etiquette, an important issue that we're going to discuss today is the issue of wearing gold in jewelry, for example, or in other parts of the dress, and for example, buttons and some other parts in which jewelry is gold is worn. Now, in this regard, we know that the Quran has not prohibited gold at all, or not even discussed this matter. However, there are narratives of the Prophet ascribed to him in which we find various things which he has said regarding gold. For example, there are certain narratives in which it is said that gold is prohibited for all, and there are certain other narratives which say that gold is prohibited for men and allowed for women, of course, alluding to the fact that gold should not be used by men. Now, in order to understand these directives, it is essential to relate these directives to the Quran, because generally when the Prophet is prohibiting something in this manner, he is actually applying a certain criteria which is discussed in the Quran. He's making an application of that directive. We find this, of course, that in the Quran, the directive of israf, or overspending, and similarly of pride and vanity being prohibited, is explicitly mentioned. And so therefore, all manifestations of pride, vanity, and israf, or overspending, were prohibited by the Prophet. And since wearing gold, particularly for men, is one such thing which gives the impression of pride, vanity, and overspending, so therefore the Prophet had prohibited this for men. And of course, if he allowed this for women, then it was only because it was part of their natural needs of embellishing themselves. And for them, if women remain in limits and embellish themselves with gold, for example, then it does not come under israf or pride and vanity. This is like fulfilling a very natural need. Now, it needs to be understood, having said all this, that all directives of the Prophet in which he is actually applying a particular directive of the Quran in a particular situation, it needs to be understood that particular directive has to be understood regarding the underlying reason of the prohibition. So what I'm trying to imply here is that if the underlying reason for this prohibition is pride, vanity, and overspending, then of course, if this underlying reason in certain societies, in certain periods of time, is not found in certain things which had been prohibited by the Prophet originally, then this prohibition shall stand cancelled or annulled simply because the underlying reason is not no longer present in that. What, in other words, can be said is that in certain societies, in certain periods of time, gold, for example, does not carry the ring of pride and vanity, if men wear it, and it also does not give the impression of overspending, then in those societies and in those times, this prohibition shall not stand. As I said, this prohibition is primarily an application of the Prophet of a particular directive of the Quran which relates to pride, vanity, and overspending. If pride, an expression of pride and arrogance and vanity and overspending, is not found in certain items which have been prohibited by the Prophet in any way, then, of course, since this underlying reason is not present, then such directive will not bear the label of prohibition. So, all in all, one can say that the prohibition of gold for men in particular, as is mentioned in certain narratives of the Prophet, is because this gives an impression of pride and vanity and arrogance, which is prohibited in the Quran. And if in certain societies this element of pride and arrogance does not exist, then of course we should not label such wearing of gold to be prohibited by men. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمُسْلِمَاتِ